And Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. We thank you for a mighty move of your Spirit, who is the teacher of the church in this house this night. And God, we are grateful that we have come to hear from you and not a man. We're grateful that someone has taught us that, the Spirit of God, who is the teacher of the church. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, motivate us to be all that you would have us to be. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. We thank you for a great move of your Spirit in this place tonight. Bless us, Lord, yes, with your word, but bless all the churches of the Inland Empire around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as you bless us, we'll give you the praise for also blessing them. In Jesus' name, we're all in agreement. We say amen. Amen. Hey, Dan, could you throw me one of those little bottles of water? Thanks, bud. So tonight, let's go to Mark, the fourth chapter. Jesus is talking to his disciples. He's walking over this land that's behind me. How cool is that? And he sits them down and he starts to talk to them about something. And what he says to them are so important that I'm going to jump right in the middle of what I'm going to teach you tonight and show you why it's important for you to listen. And then we'll come back to verse number one and we'll start and we'll go from there. But here, if you will, go with me into Mark, the fourth chapter, and let's start in verse number nine. And he said to them, speaking to his disciples, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." I mean, if we didn't do anything, we just stopped right there tonight and made a statement to you. Listen to me now, that has ears to hear, you better hear. This is serious. He doesn't make that statement one time, but see if you can count them as I read to you. And even at the end, he makes it again. Verse number 10. But when he was alone, speaking with his guys, those around him were the 12, asked him about the parable that he had just spoken. We're going to stop, read that parable to you because it's an interesting parable. But he makes a statement about the parable. He says, and he said to them, verse number 11, "To you it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God." Tonight, if you're in this house and you have a desire and you feel like you're washed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, God has given you the ability to know, and I love this, the mysteries of the kingdom of God. These mysteries that we're talking about is what makes you prosperous in every area of your life. In the economics of your life. In the relationships of your life. Husband, wife, children, relatives. In this word, prosper means everything you deal with in your health, in your status, in your going and coming, and everything you put your hand to. You have been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, just like his disciples. You're not any different. When you got born of the Spirit of God, you are his disciples. You now belong to him. How you belong to him makes all the difference in whether or not you're going to be able to understand the mysteries of God and then start to apply them to correct the direction in which you're going to get into the place where God wants you to be. Somebody listen. Very important for it to take place because he goes on. You have been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God. But to those who are outside, all things come in parables. In other words, those that are really not with God. It's best to speak to them in parables because they're not going to get it anyway. Because if they got it, they'd get saved, and that'd be great, but they're not going to get it. Why? Because they're not inside, they're where? outside. Now watch this. Verse 12. So that, speaking of the people that are outside, seeing they may see and not perceive, hearing they may hear and not understand, at least they should turn and their sins be forgiven them. Wow, wouldn't that be great? Why doesn't it work for them? Because they had ears, but they didn't hear. And they heard a parable that they didn't understand. And they were in the wrong place, thought they were okay. And instead of making the change to the right place, if you're in the right place, you will know it. But if you're in the wrong place and you don't make the change, guess what, my friends? There's no help for you. And that's what he's saying right here. Verse number 13 comes along and he makes this statement. And he said to them, do you not understand the parable? How then will you understand all the parables? In other words, this is the very first basic understanding you need to have about not only God, but you need to have about yourself. And I think most people don't have this. I think most churches have not taught this correctly. And that we need to see that he's talking to us literally. He says, do you not understand? This is talking to his disciples. These guys ate with him. These guys slept with him. This guy hung around him, walked with him, saw the miracles, listened to his words. They weren't just there occasionally on a Sunday. They were there 24-7. Everywhere he went, they went. And now he comes along and he says, question them. He says, you know, I give you a parable and you don't even understand. But if you don't understand that parable, how are you going to understand anything else I'm going to say to you? Because remember, Jesus talks, if you go back to early chapters in Matthew, Jesus talks, he says, I don't talk according to the flesh. I talk according to what the Father says to me. It's the flesh doesn't receive what the Spirit's saying. And so when Jesus is talking, these parables, which are so phenomenal, and that's why we entitle this message, these profound words of Jesus, and it's called Choices. Because without understanding that they're profound, and he's just really challenging his disciples. My goodness, this is the beginning and you don't understand it. I wonder how many people in church understand it. I wonder if people in the church properly evaluate where they're at with God and will have the guts to say, I'm not where I need to be, and have the guts to say, I need to make the change to get to where I need to be. Because I know if I get to where God wants me to be, man, all the junk I live in is over with. All the crap that takes care of my life every day, it's over with. I just move on in the victory of the things of God. And as an old man, I'm telling you the truth. Deborah and I experience that every day of our life. We're not just here, just fell out of a turnip truck or a seminary truck. We're here telling you something. The truth is that we've lived this. This really does work. There's something you need to recognize where you're at, and then there's some changes you need to make in this house tonight and forever. Why? Because God's speaking to you. Now, in order to understand the parable that he's talking about, let me read it to you, starting in verse number 1. Well, he'll give you some parable, and I'll explain a little bit about it. And then after he says all of these to these guys, he comes back and he breaks it down so that you can understand it. And man, that's where the rubber meets the road. That's where the personal evaluation of ourselves has got to start taking place. You know, these days, I've seen a lot of things in my life. Over the years of serving God, when I was a young man, my early 30s, Debbie and I got married. We were both so excited about Jesus, we just wanted to serve him. I didn't care where or what, I just wanted to serve him. So I remember we were thinking about being missionaries. And I realized that I didn't really have a heart for that kind of lifestyle. And that there must have been something else that God wanted me to do. I was willing to do anything. I mean, we were so excited. I cleaned the toilets in the church that I attended until the pastor himself came to me and said, I don't want you cleaning the toilets of this church. I literally thought that's a thing I could do is clean toilets. And I cleaned toilets every week in the church until I was ordered to stop from him. I just didn't see myself as anything but a toilet cleaner. But a toilet cleaner in the kingdom of God is better than somebody who's outside thinking he's a big shot, you know. I didn't know that God had this supernatural life waiting for Deborah and I. Honored by our college 20 years, they took my class and they translated my class every single word that I spoke. Gosh, I hope they skipped some of them. I haven't read it yet, but it's 400 words in this book that they presented to us. I was not feeling good and was sick and wasn't here that night. And taking my healing as I stand before you. And but it's amazing the honor that you will have because you have served God all the days of your life. It's just unbelievable. He says this in chapter 4, verse number 1, and again he began to teach by the sea, and he and a great multitude was gathered to him. So that he got into the boat and he sat in it on the sea, and the whole multitude was on the land facing the sea. And he taught them many things by parables. Why do you think he was teaching them by parables? You remember? They have to understand they're on the outside. They're not going to get it. So the multitude is there. They're chasing after Jesus. And he's still speaking parables to them because they're on the outside and couldn't understand. Sometimes we can chase after Jesus, go to church, carry our Bible, and we still don't understand anything, and therefore we never change from where we're at. We never recognize we're in the wrong place. We never get up and go to the right place because we don't know any better. We think we're okay when we're not okay. Man. And he taught them many things by parables and said to them in his teaching. It's really interesting that these words preserved thousands of years and numerous times they're expressed. So it's not something that's just, I mean, God, after he's gone, Holy Spirit comes and quickens to these men's minds and hearts the words, exact words that Jesus spoke. That's called the inspiration. And they wrote them down. Listen, verse 3. And I love this word, listen, because let those that have ears to hear, hear. And then he comes along and says, listen. Do you see the next word, behold? It means listen. It means this, pay attention. This is important. You ought to get this. Man, this is words of Jesus. Listen, behold, check it out. It's important that you get it. And he says, a sower went out to sow. Now, just real quick, just to give you an idea what a sower is, we live in a society, we don't understand that, but it's farming in those days. They would spread seed. Sometimes they'd put them in trenches. Sometimes if they had the proper water. Sometimes they would just put them on the ground and cover them up the best they could. But they'd sow the seed from a sack. Sometimes you'll see people that are doing their lawn. They'll take it and they'll throw the seeds. They have little seed throwers nowadays. You wind them like this and the seeds go everywhere, throwing seeds all over your lawn. Same thing, you're sowing seeds. Verse number 4 says these words. He says, and it happened as he sowed. So here he's throwing these seeds, that some seeds fell by the wayside. And the birds of the air came and devoured it. Now, this is just a story for most people that read it, but this is one category of person that's in this room right now. Fascinating. Verse 5. Some fell on stony ground, and there it did not much earth, and immediately it sprang up because it had no depth of earth. Verse number 6. But when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. Second category of person that's in this room right now. Verse number 7. And verse number 7 says, and some seed fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no crop. Third category were the seeds that fell among the thorns and yield no crop. Very interesting that you remember these words. Yield no crop. It was so choked that it could not produce anything. That's third category. Fourth category, as we read, and other seeds fell on good ground and yield a crop that sprang up, increased, and produced some 30, some 60, and some 100. Now, after he said this, he goes with his disciples, and that's where we started in verse number 9. So let me tie it all together for you. Watch this and follow me for just a moment. In verse number 9, he comes along and he says these words. And he said to them, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Verse number 10. Let's just go kind of quick through this. I'll just read it. But when he was alone, those around him with the 12 came to him about the parable. Verse number 11. And he said to them, To you, it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God. But to those who are on the outside, all things come in parables. They don't quite understand it. And here's what happens and why they don't understand. Verse number 13. Because if they did understand it, verse 13, verse 13. And he said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the other parables?" In other words, I just told you something. And what he told us, could you admit this to me? That most of us, if he just left us there, would not understand completely what he said. Could I get a witness on that? Well, even me, after all these years, if I was just left for what I read in the first part of the parable, I really wouldn't have understood it any more than his disciples understood it and are now talking to him about it. So don't feel bad about that. Now here it comes along, verse number 14, and he makes this statement. He says, "On the sower sowed the words." So all of a sudden he comes along and he makes this statement. The sower sows the word. What the seed was that he sowed, is everybody listening, is now being defined. So now he's going to explain to them what the parable means. And it's been written for you and I to look into so that we can evaluate where we're at. Over the years, I've seen thousands and thousands and thousands of people get saved. I'm a soul winner. We average 13,000 salvations that walk the aisles at this church every year, average. Probably a little more than that since we've been doing it. That's not for 28 years, but for probably a good 25 years or 26 years. Do the math. That's hundreds of thousands of people, my friends, have been saved at this church. I have this big question all the time. If we're talking about a couple, anybody do the math? I know some of you are really smart, and you just got your iPhone, you just did the math, like 25 years times 13,000 is how much? Did anybody do it? What? You guys are listening too much to me. How much was it?
266,500.
Say it again.
266,500.
266,500. That is a quarter of a million people have walked down these aisles since this church started. I'm not talking about people who got saved in the food pantry and the food distribution center. Not talking about people that get saved at convalescent hospitals. We don't add up the prisons. We don't add up our missions conferences. We don't add up missionaries all around the world to get people saved. We don't add up anything. Just over a quarter of a million people have been saved in this church. Is that good for you? Let me ask you this. I'm going to throw cold water on your clap. Where are they? Isn't that sickening? Where are they? Here we are. We're probably a couple thousand people tonight, if that. Where are they? Quarter of a million people got saved. Where are they? The next verse tells us where they're at. Can I just have the next verse? First category. And these are the ones that by the wayside. Remember there was a guy that's going along, he threw the seed out and some fell by the wayside. And his expression was, the birds came immediately and ate them. And they were lost. These are ones by the wayside that when the word is sown, when they hear, Satan comes immediately to take away the word that is sown, put out, given into their, what's that word? Oh my goodness. At one moment of their life, something of God dropped down on the inside of their heart. And they had received Jesus on the inside, but immediately something happens that comes and drives them, that which is seed in their heart, drives that seed out of their heart. And that's why the most important ministry in this church is spiritual personal trainers. You guys just don't know it. Because once someone walks to that back room back there, it's there in that back room that we've got to plant seeds of protection where they get to a place where they understand how important it is that they're going to be resisted, that they're going to have the enemy come. There's someone coming to talk to them and tell them that they're foolish to believe that Jesus stuff. And a lot of times we get people saying, oh, shout, we clap, just like we just did. And if we don't get them ready to put a value on what they have received so that they're ready to protect what it is that they've received, they'll be removed. Did you get that? If you don't put a value on what you received, it'll be removed. And that's what happened to the quarter of a million people that walked the aisles of every church in America. Every church in America, every person that gives their heart and life to Jesus, heard the word, and the word resonated in their heart, immediately here comes Satan. I remember this one young man, so excited about getting saved. When we were young, you know, I used to call people that got saved. I didn't do it. I just needed the church to grow, so I don't do that anymore. But in those days, I'd call everybody. I'd call everybody that was a first-time giver or write them a note. Say, thank you for giving, God. I mean, we were so broke, we couldn't pay the electric bills for years. We had to, you know, shuffle everything around just to make things work. And I'd write every person that gave anything, thank you so much for giving. Thank you, thank you, thank you for trusting us. I'd write, handwrite, you know. And now I wouldn't do anything else but that. And then also, every person that got saved, I would call them or write them a note or something. We had people going after them immediately. Remember Pastor Richard, how you used to go after them immediately on the phone ministry and call them on the phone? We don't do that so much anymore. That's where the SPT comes in now. And man, you SPTs need to go after these people, because if you don't, here comes the enemy to rob the seed out of their heart. That's the first category. Now let me tell you something. The other day I was watching television. It was like some great name university back east, like Cambria or Harvard or one of those kind of big schools. And they had a graduation. And they had a guy that had multiple doctorate degrees. He was an older man. I would say maybe not as old as me, but an older man. And he had his stripes on his gowns, and he was very profound in the things he said. And he was speaking to thousands that were graduating at this university. And somehow he made this one statement. He says, you know, in life you're going to do this, you're going to do that, you're going to follow this, you're going to follow that. And then he came along and he made a statement to that entire crowd. And he says, you might be one of those stupid people that still believe that there's a God. He laughs out loud and he says, you know, hey, listen, do you think that some people could ever really believe that silly stuff? And it just broke my heart. Because he was looked at as an authority figure, incredibly intelligent, incredibly successful, and he was there as a tool of Satan to rob anything that was in the heart of man out. And every one of those, just like that young man I was telling you about, when he went home, his father said to him, I'll never forget this because I followed up with him. His father said to him, he was a drug addict. He said, I'd much rather have you a drug addict than a Christian. He says, I forbid you to go back to church. And he said, Daddy, okay. Immediately, Satan comes to rob from your heart. And that's why we lose so many people here at the Rock Church that don't go forward. Second category starts to explain, which is really fascinating to me. And I love this one. Because if I can, let me just read this once again. The sower sows the word, verse number 14. And those are won by the wayside, and the word was sown. And when they hear, and Satan comes immediately, the word that was sown in their hearts. And he says these words, verse 16, these likewise are the ones. Likewise what? Like what? Like the first category. And he says, and these like the first category. Watch this, verse number 16. Are sown on stony ground. And remember what he said before. He says they fell on stony ground and it was not much earth and immediately it sprang up, but it had no depth. And when the sun came out, it scorched it. But watch what he says in verse 16. Are stony ground, who when they hear the word, immediately receive it with gladness. Wow, isn't that a good position? Haven't we seen lots of people here at the Rock Church that receive the word of God with gladness? Can I tell you something? Nobody gets saved unless they receive the word of God with some gladness. They're happy they heard it. Now here comes this amazing story. It talks about us. And this could be where you're at tonight. And this is why you need to know that to make some changes. Now watch this. In verse number 16, they receive it with gladness. But verse 17, and they have no, remember this second category, no root in themselves. And can I just stop you right there? I want you to look at the words up on the overhead with me. And they have no root in themselves. They have no root, not in God. They receive the word with gladness, but they have no root of God in themselves. And so only endure for a time. Haven't you seen people come to church after they've been saved? They'll come for 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 weeks, you know, and all of a sudden they stop coming again. Something happens to them. What happened? So we had SBTs to chase after them, but sometimes poor SBTs get beat up, man. And that's a tough job you have, but guess what? The soul is worth it. He says, afterwards, then tribulation. I can't tell you how many people we will hear about that just got saved and enter into this unbelievable tribulation, pressure. And the first thing a young person says that has received the word, it doesn't know everything. They say, God, where's God in this? I give my life to Jesus, all of a sudden the whole world falls apart on top of me. But if we had prepared them as a church, if we had got them set up to know that not only is Satan coming immediately, but after a short period of time, the pressures of life are going to come on you. With tribulation or persecution arise for the word's sake, that's the seed that was planted. In other words, man, here's Satan coming after them to get that which is out of them. And he didn't get it immediately, but he'll get it next week, or he'll get it in 2 weeks or 3 or 5 weeks, he gets it from them. He says, immediately they, gosh, I just had this flash. There was a guy sitting, and always sat in this side. Man, he was so excited when he got saved. I'm telling you guys, if I could tell you something, I'll bet he was here for almost a year. I remember seeing him because he wore his hair a certain way that reminded me of somebody I knew in the past. So that's why I kind of identified with him. And I knew his name and I called his name every time I see him at the door, you know. And all of a sudden I saw him less and less and less and less until he's not here anymore. Immediately they stumble. Immediately can mean immediately, like boom, or it can mean immediately in the time of God, which means weeks, months, years from now, but they stumble. That doesn't matter when it happens. They just got to stumble. And that's Satan's job. Second category, verse number 18. We go to the third category. Now these are the ones sown among the thorns. They're the ones who hear the word, verse 19, and the cares of the world. I love this. And the deceitfulness of riches and the desire for other things. In other words, these people have no importance. One has no value. One has no understanding and no fight. This third category has no importance placed on the Word of God. So when things come in, and they, has anybody ever been a Christian and realized that there are desires that we still have and we still love money? Let's be honest. We like to have it. We feel better about ourselves when we have it, when we don't. But it's not money that's evil. It's the love of money that's evil. Deceitful riches and the cares of the world. How many cares are there? Jobs, cars, kids, bosses. How many cares are there? People you have to get along with, you don't want to get along with. The cares of the freeway, cares of this, cares of that. Everything coming at you pulls you away. Didn't say they're lost. Didn't say they immediately failed or fall. But it says something very interesting about this one. It says they became unfruitful. And I believe a lot of the American church is there. Let me explain what I mean by that. We've had numbers of second houses. Second house is you have your own home, then you buy a house in a resort area. We've had them in San Diego. We've had them, Deborah and I, over the years, in the islands of Newport Beach. We've had them. I mean, God's blessed us economically. Can't know the word like Deborah and I do and not get blessed economically. It'd be a tragedy for me to say God's going to bless you, but I'm in poverty and they never really blessed me. I'm telling you, I'm so blessed you can't understand it. Went through a recession. What we lost, we only dreamt of ever making in our life, and we still came out blessed. And here's the deal with all of that. We don't have many more because I don't have time for them. When I had the second house, I felt like I had to go to it all the time. And all of a sudden, if I wasn't a pastor, which I was because I had to be here, I would make a statement, well, you know, if I'm spending that kind of money every month and I've got this house that I need to go to and the only time I have off is weekends, and all of a sudden the second house becomes the deceitful riches of the world are desires for other things that choked off my relationship from the Word of God. And we find ourselves oftentimes operating in worldly things, calling ourselves Christians. And yes, we're Christians, and yes, we're going to die and go to heaven. But here's the problem. Last few three words. It became unfruitful. And that's where we have with most Christians. I don't know where you're at, but that's where a lot of times we're so caught up in our business, we're so caught up in our homes, our plane, the cares of the world, the deceitfulness of riches, and all the things that it does to play on us, that we find ourselves in a place where we actually don't ever have time to produce fruit. By the way, when he uses the word unfruitful, doesn't not Jesus make this statement, you or the Word of God make this statement, you will know them by their fruit. Let me try that again. You will know them, speaking of Christians, by their fruit. And that's why most of the time, American churches, even in our church, my friends, we have a lot of people come to church now and then, but have no fruit. And that's a shame. It's because they allowed those three things to get into a relationship that kept them from the prosperity of God. And they settled for the prosperity of this world, which, may I say to you, is disgusting compared to the moment of the anointing of God. D- Didn't say you can't have it. Didn't say God didn't want you to have the abundance. Didn't say God didn't even want you to have the second home. I didn't say that. You can have all that stuff. But don't stop being fruitful wherever you go. Don't stop being fruitful. When you stop being fruitful, then you know you're in this category, number three. Which brings us to the fourth category. Are you listening tonight?
Yes.
Which is the nicest one we all think we're in, we're not. Is that okay? I don't want to be tough on anybody, you know, and I don't want to be mean, but I do want to be frank. And I don't want to say it like it is. I can't stand people that beat around the bush. Tell me what it is. If I make a mistake, I'll apologize to you. That's the difference between me and Donald. And I won't call you names, but I'll say it like it is. And I'll say I'm sorry, because I do make mistakes, and he doesn't know it, but so does he. Verse 20, but these are those are the ones sown in good ground. Now he defines good ground, two things. Who hear the word of God, that's one. And second, three things. Accept it. And the third thing, bear fruit. The people who have the seed falling on good ground, hear it, accept it, and with that, bear fruit. And God said you'd know them by their fruit. Yeah. Some, didn't matter how much. Some, 30. Some, 60-fold. Some, 100. Isn't an issue. How much? It's a matter of what it is. A lot of times we stop and say, oh, you know, it's very important for me to produce 100. I'm glad you feel that way. But even if you produced 30, God says that's good too. That's good ground. So there's four categories of believers in our churches. People who want to go somewhere, want to get blessed by God, but don't want to make the change to get to where they need to be, and they don't make the change because they really don't recognize where they're at. And they don't understand. Look, if I don't know how to get to Lake Arrowhead, I'm going to drive everywhere to get to Lake Arrowhead. But if I understand how to get on the 18 and how to get off at the top of the mountain at Arrowhead, I'm going to end up at Lake Arrowhead. I have to have the directions to know how to get to the direction where I'm going. And what God does tonight is he tells you, here's a little look into your own heart. Where are you? The first one comes along and he makes a statement. He says, they hear it, immediately Satan comes, robs it. And that'll happen in this place every time we have church. Whether you respond tonight or not, it'll happen. Second, is that there's a people who will not only protect the word and place no value. That's the first one. But the second category, there's no understanding and no fight for the word. So when the pressures of life and persecution comes, they fall apart. The third one is not pressures of persecution, but it's a people who find themselves without an importance placed on the word. And when all the stuff of the world comes, that distracts them. One of the things that blesses me, I married this amazing woman. I just tell you the truth with all of my heart, if I could tell you the truth. I'm more in love with my Debbie today. And I think she's more beautiful today than the day that I married her. And she says, oh, you just have old eyes. And I say, Mama, I do, but you are beautiful. And the reason I fell in love with her wasn't her looks, even though, man, she's good looking. I fell in love with her, wasn't for her shape, even though she has a phenomenal shape, It's like a little hourglass. Wasn't because she could, the reason I fell in love with her, because on the inside of her was this big God. And I needed help. I needed help to get to this big God. In those days, I was 6'5" and 240 pounds. Total and complete man. Anything different than that, let's go. And I'll prove it to you. And I had a hard time many times not coming out of the pulpit area and smack some of these people that are in church. I mean, I'm not afraid to fight. My father was a fighter, a boxer. I've always been, I was a professional athlete. And I'm here to tell you something. I'm all man. The woman, because of the God that's in her, I fell in love and she helped me to see the difference between being a sluggard or someone that's partial or something. She was so committed. To this day, we have coffee or tea together in the morning. I'm telling you, the first hour, she talks about Jesus. She'll cry. She'll laugh. I'm staring out the window looking at birds. I'm drinking my tea, coffee. She's having this emotional breakdown. I'm going, oh, my God, I've married Isaiah the prophet's sister. And it's like, but the woman has helped me to become the man of God that I needed to be. Now, you don't need Deborah or you don't need me. You just need the Word. And that's what it is. Here's what it is. I saw where I was, in other words, I would have gone in the wrong direction. And she kept me on course. I'd have gone with the ways of the world. I'd have gone for the deceitful riches. I'd have gone for, I didn't know any better. But now I know better. And I learned that many years ago. God has prospered us. And now there's 30, 60, are a hundredfold return. What do you think putting an effort in to get a quarter of a million people is worth? Out of that quarter of a million, about 12% stayed with the things of God. Now, our job is to grow up and become fruitful for the last years of your life. If you don't, you're missing out on the abundance that God has for you. I don't know where you're at, but I pray God show you and make the changes to become good ground that receives the Word of God and produces and fight the good fight to get all that stuff off of you that wants to pull you back. If God spoke to you, come on, give Him a great big praise. Isn't the profound words of Jesus amazing? I mean, it's like they explode all over us. I was in Matthew, going through Matthew, and I get, oh, gosh, I don't know if I can teach some of that stuff. It's so like, you've got to be kidding me. And he was building his disciples at that time. And he was painting the worst of the worst pictures about commitment. Eat my flesh and drink my blood. Oh, my God. Who talks that way? This guy's nuts. He's a cannibal. We need to go back and get out of here. But a small group of people just stayed with him. What he was talking about was communion, but he wasn't talking about it in terms that they understood. It was by the Spirit. And so, guys, there's many words of Jesus, profound words of Jesus that are phenomenal. I just want to talk to you just before you leave tonight. Let's see if those of you that are here tonight, that you heard the Word of God, somehow inside of your heart right now, you know it's true. And you know where you're at. But here's the question I have. Now think about this. Do you have the courage to make the change? Because the change starts with this. If you haven't given God all of your heart, you have to give it to Him. And you haven't given God all of your life, you have to give it to Him. Then you're really not born again. There's no doubt that you know who Jesus is, or we wouldn't be here tonight. We've sung songs. We've talked about Jesus. You heard about him at Christmas. You know about the resurrection at Easter. You know Jesus. Come on now. You know that. But it's not about knowing Jesus in your head that gets you to heaven. It's about having a wholehearted commitment with Jesus from your heart. And a lot of people miss Jesus by 18 inches from the head to the heart, because they think they're Christians in their thinking, because their mama told them they were Christians, their daddy took them to church, they went to catechism class or Sunday school or Sabbath school class when they were a child, they put a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. You're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. God is good, God is something, but God is not everything. And the seed has not landed yet on good ground. And until it's in good ground, ready to fight that fight against the things of the world and your flesh and satanic principles and even the things of the world that would come in and choke it out, you'll never produce anything. And tonight, maybe some of you need to start the right way by giving God all of your heart. That's what Jesus was talking about in John, the third chapter. You must be born again, he says. To be born again from the beginning of the Bible, if you don't know what it means, to the end of the Bible, here's what it means. It means you've given God all of your heart. It means you've given God all of your life. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, what God's after is a good ground that's going to stay. And that seed's going to produce the goodness of God throughout your life. That's fruit. Listen to what I'm going to say to you. Some of you, you haven't got there. And you need to get there by giving God all of your heart and all of your life. I'm going to make a statement that's a crazy statement to most of you. You might as well listen to it. The statement is this. Are you ready? It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Yeah? It always has been. It always will be. God forgive us in American churches because we wanted people to come and we wanted their money. God forgive us that we watered that down. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. I'll prove it to you. Last book in the Bible, the book of Revelation. Jesus himself is speaking. He says, I'm coming again. And when I come, and you know what, guys, stop right there. Listen to this. You know he's coming. And he says, when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. I will, listen to the words, how graphic, how rude are these words. You always think Jesus had nothing but nice things to say. He says, I'll vomit you from my mouth. This is nothing to mess with, my friends. Here, Jesus says, come. Come. You've heard the word of truth tonight. Now it's time to receive the word of God with gladness and let a church help you to fight the temptations of the devil, the ploys of this world, and even the things that want to come from the world, from your flesh, that'll keep you from being all that God would have you to be. That's what we do at this church. That's what we do. We make disciples. Let us help you to do that. You'll make a disciple to me or to Pastor Dan or Pastor Luke or to Deborah. You make a disciple to Jesus. That's what this is all about. And tonight you need to make the commitment to give God all of your heart. But I don't want you to make a commitment that just says, I'll do it for tonight. And I don't have to do anything more than that. Because you see what happened to those that did no more than that? They all fell away. They didn't make it. Or they lived a life that was unproductive. And tonight is your night of salvation. All across this auditorium. Even you that are on internet live right now, I'm talking to some of you right out there right now. I'm not playing games with you. Go turn the channel and get somebody else to play games with you. I'm too old to play games with you. I'm telling you the truth. If you don't give Jesus all of your heart and all of your life, you're going to die and go to hell. And you don't want that to happen. But somebody needs to tell you. And someday you will face Jesus Christ. And may I say this to you? You'll thank God for an old man telling you the truth. And today is your day of salvation all across the internet. About 1,000 of you listening. Tonight is your night of salvation. You say, Pastor, how do I do it? Let's do it God's way. Let's don't do it my way. Let's don't do it your way. Let's don't do it some well-meaning church committee's way. Let's do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. So in a moment, I'm going to ask you in a moment to put your hand up. I'm going to go like this. I'll go 1, 2, 3, and I'll pop my hands together. It'll sound like this. Bang! And when you hear that sound, 1, 2, 3, bang! You hear that sound, your hand goes up. What you're saying by the raising of your hand is I heard the word tonight, and I don't want to go to hell, and I want to go to heaven, and I want to receive the seed that was sown in my heart, and I want you to help me to fight to keep it there. And you will get so blessed you won't know what to do with life. But it starts with you making the commitment of all of your heart and all of your life. And all across this auditorium, who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? And I don't know who you are, but there's some of you in here have been running from God more than you've been running to God. It's you I'm talking to. If you've never given him all of your heart, it's you I'm talking to. If you've never really given him all of your life, you just had head knowledge about Jesus because you went through some spiritual system. It doesn't work that way. It's about the heart, not a system. Tonight is your night of salvation. I don't care if you have a Bible in your lap and you've marked it up a dozen times, but have you given him all of your heart and all of your life? I don't care if you went to Bible college. I don't care if you graduated seminary. I don't care if you've been a pastor for 50 years. If you're not giving Jesus all your heart and all of your life, you're going to die and go to hell because you must be born again. I'm going to count to three. Your call, your choice. Hey, you say, wait a minute, Pastor, if I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. People I came with will see me. People behind me will see me. I'll feel funny. Yep, you might. But get over it. I won't embarrass you. It's better to feel embarrassed in a safe place like this house of God than to be in hell forever and ever because you care more about what people think instead of what God sees. Today, it's your choice, your call. I've done my job. I told you the truth and loved you to tell you the truth. I'm ready to say it now and count. And you need to put your hand up and you know who you are. And don't give a flip about anybody else. And certainly don't let the one who was once to immediately rob the word from your heart keep you from doing what you know to do. Are you ready? Here it is. 1, 2, 3. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. All across this auditorium. Let me see your hands. There's 1. Thank you. There's 2. Thank you. There's 3. Thank you. There's 4. Back over here. Thank you. There's 5. God bless you. There's 5 that are going to go for Jesus tonight. Anybody else? Real quick. There's another one. Back over here. Thank you. God bless you. 6. Thank you. That's a wise person. These are 6 wise people. Anybody else that needs, did I embarrass them? No. You don't even know which ones raised their hands. So if you're going to not do this, that's your call. But you heard the word, and you know you need to. And tonight it's yours. I saw you. Go ahead and put your hand up. There's 6 wise people. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? Anybody else? I'm going to close this down. You're going to miss this. 6 wise people. Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, praise God. Let's give the Lord a great big hand for 6 wise people. Here's what I want all 6 of you to do, even in the family room. You can get a hold of your kids and your stuff and your purse. Ushers, go up there and help them do this. Get out of that seat, all across this auditorium. We're going to stand in a moment. We're going to clap for you. But all 6 of you that raised your hand, I want you to get out of your seat. I want you to bring your stuff, coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. If you had a friend, you came with a friend, come on, friend. Say to them, let's go. I'll go with you. Say to your neighbor, let's go. I'll go with you. Get out of your seat. Come down here and meet me right here in front. All 6 of you and anybody else that needs to come, you come right now. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Oh, they're coming, give me a hand. They're coming, give me a hand. Come on, you come too. Come on. Come on, come on, come on. They're still coming.
Jesus, if you're not my one.
Come on, you come too. Anybody else who needs to come, come. We'll sing it one more time. Come on. Well, thank God you guys have come. Listen, you heard the word and you responded. Immediately, Satan's going to come try to knock this out. You can go tell somebody, they're going to say, oh, they're stupid people. You've made a mistake. You're following fools. Trust me. You saw the Bible yourself. Don't let anybody talk you out of this. Immediately, they're going to come try to rob the heart. Then there's going to be problems. Let us help you with those problems during this time of growth. So we're here for you. That's what this is really all about. We have young groups for 18 to 30-year-olds. We have people that are different groups that will meet with you. We have spiritual personal trainers that will help you. That's what we were talking about earlier. That's these guys standing behind you. And here's over here is Pastor Joel. He'll pray with you just for a moment to invite Jesus in your heart, because you need to do that as an invite him in. Because if you don't get saved walking down the aisle, you don't say raise your hand. He's a gentleman. You've got to invite him to come into your heart, and you want to do that. And he'll lead you in a quick little short prayer, and he's just great about that. Then he's going to encourage you about those four things, you know. And you SBTs, they're going to bug you because they love you. So know that you're bugged because you're loved. Is that okay? I mean, that because we don't want you to go, like he said, fall back, not do anything with their life. We want you to get totally and completely blessed. That's what this is all about. People who came with a wait for you, this only takes a few minutes. Make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right over that way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.